You know, we hear so much about invasive plants, and for good reason, but let's just think about the context of what are we talking about. Here in Massachusetts, we have a flora of about 2,700, 2,800 plants. Of those, literally, like almost right on the money, a third, 898, are non-native, introduced, non-indigenous. So a third of our flora is non-native. But if you look at the numbers of plants, the individual species that are listed as invasive or likely invasive, it's a very, very tiny percentage. So, not to sound like quite like Bernie Sanders, but I will use some percentages. So we're talking about literally about 1% of the species that are moving out into the landscape in areas that are not, you know, managed in general, and have the capacity to invade natural habitats. So here in Massachusetts so far, there are 35 plants that the state's advisory group has deemed invasive. Then there's another 31 that are likely invasive species. And needless to say, in Northampton, of the 35, the species that are invasive, we have all but five, okay? Which is sort of not so surprising. And this list includes species that are on the invasive list, likely invasive, and one or two others that are either in the as yet to be determined category, or one that I think maybe should rise up to something that we focus on, which is the Canada thistle in some of our habitats, like down at Montview, for instance, yeah. Or in some places at Arcadia. But so this is a list to guide you really thinking about Northampton, but as Gabby says, probably like many other communities, you know, the same species will be an issue. And many of them are at conservation areas. But the good news is, like here in the Mineral Hills, aside from these historically altered margins or some of the wetland areas, the core of the Mineral Hills, the core of the Sawmill Hills, the core of Fitzgerald Lake, basically is almost entirely free of invasives. So that's the really good news. So today, this is a nice site. We're going to see of the worst of the species, we're going to see about 50% of them today. And we're going to see a couple that are new and ones to watch for, which are sort of one of the exciting ones that I saw last night. But I think the other thing that's going to be really interesting with this group is, and going forward, is that, like, you know, it all depends on what the lens is that you're wearing, and how you perceive how common or uncommon they are. And it depends, of course, like what habitats you're running around. But for instance, today, on your list, not on the new revised list that Bob will send to you, one of the species that I didn't include because I thought, well, you know, I see it in Northampton, but it's like not such a big deal, is this one, which today, driving over here, I thought, ooh, I definitely should have
put barberry.
And barberry has been here in Northampton since at least the 1850s. Sylvester Judd writes about finding it in Paradise, which is the area that the Mill River folks are working on. And that kids used to go and collect the fruits to eat. Now, so this is Japanese barberry.
And Bergeron.
Yeah. And this is common barberry.
Vulgaris. Oh,
and this is the hybrid.
Oh, hybrid.
So just a couple things to note, and then we'll pass these around.
Is carefully. That,
Carefully. Yeah, carefully. But here's a public health component. Turns out that this is barberry, when you have areas in former pastures and old fields, and barberry really comes in abundance. Maybe some of you know this, that it turns out that the humidity regime in those settings is a little bit moister. And there's some a researcher down in Connecticut found that deer ticks, there's a public health component, because there are more deer ticks in barberry patches, and because basically there's a humidity regime, and the mice that are the short-term hosts are basically protected by this spiny cage. Mm. And so, and out in the just forested landscape, the deer ticks don't do as well, but in this capacity. So here's the common one, I mean the Japanese one. It only has one needle, and you'll see it comes out, and it's not on a, you can see how different this is with this long, bright
cluster instead of just an armpit.
And this is triple, and this has toothed margins on the leaves, whereas this is entire. And this is like right in the middle. How beautiful is that? And I can actually cut this up. Oh, more people can have it.
So we can spread it around.
Wow.
But
I've never noticed this. You know, the three needles.
But this one has no. And this is like right in the middle of
the needle. What about the needles? This is the
hybrid. This is the hybrid.
And it has the one needle?
This has one needle, entire leaves, but more panicle-y. Things.
So the Japanese doesn't have the, you know, you don't see the you call it panicle.
Yeah, it's just hanging like that.
Oh, you just get that.
And this blooms a little bit earlier.
Mercedes. Okay. This is the common.
Are the others as invasive as the Japanese?
Is
the
So this common barberry is less common here in Northampton. It's a species that maybe you see more over in Berkshire County, I thought. But today driving here, like opposite of your house, along the road there, that's where I stopped.
No, I know there. I've seen that in bloom, but I didn't know what it was.
And there's some that are probably 7 feet tall along Sylvester Road.
So can you put Sylvester Road in that grant?
Is that part of the Mill River watershed?
I don't know.
Spines, modified leaves, like an acanthus.
So here's another species which I'm really worried about. It's sort of to be determined. This is something. This is in the same family as a bittersweet. It's a euonymus, it's called winter creeper, and it's a species which, 20 years ago, again, like what lens was I wearing? I don't know, but I did not see it, and now when you go home today, it's harder, but in the winter because it remains evergreen. You see it climbing up these stems, and I've found it in, I don't think I've found it here in the Mineral Hills, but basically I think I've found it in every other conservation area.
Does it have a flower?
Yes, an insipid looking greenish thing that you would never really, won't make your heart race, and you won't probably even notice it. But in the Mill River, near Smith College, it's carpeting the understory. It can form dense mats. And similarly, for those of you who are familiar, the city recently received a 6-acre parcel down near the dike behind what was the Northampton School for Girls and is now Cutchins. And that area, that is like a sea of invasives. You look at these catalpas down there and you think, if you don't know what they are, you think, those must be really old trees. This is like a beautiful floodplain forest. And as you start looking, you think, oh, it's mostly catalpa. And then, but in that setting, as well as the Mill River, this winter creeper is just all over. Mm. And then here's another one. We're going to see many examples of honeysuckle here. This is the other species, Tatarica, and But these hybridize a lot. We're going to see a lot of pink and yellow today. I mean, white and yellow, not so much pink. And so this is one that is not on your list because I don't think it's so common in Northampton yet. But it's one to like pay attention to.
I have it in my yard, pink.
Yeah,
it's pretty.
Yeah. Your yard is not so bad. I've been to your
property. Okay. It feels bad now that you're listing all this stuff.
Many other communities have as much conservation land, or sometimes more, but it's owned by the state, it's owned by the federal government, or it's owned by private land trusts. As an entity, the city of Northampton, I think, is really in its own category, like Amherst, set the bar very high in terms of protecting conservation land. But the important part of that is that if you look at the city of Northampton in terms of those other entities, private land trusts, state or federal, without the cities doing it, buying it, we wouldn't have as much. I mean, we're sort of on average same as other communities, but were it not for the city's acquisition, we'd be way below in terms of open space protection.
And how do we compare in care?
Well, there's the thing, and you know, it's just so interesting because back in the 1970s, like you buy a piece of property, maybe you'd have to worry about people throwing trash there or improving the trail, but basically you say like, okay, that piece is protected. But it's totally changed, really. I mean, 1958 is when this first seminal book on the ecology of invasions of by plants and animals by a guy named Elton. It was sort of the beginning. And people could certainly understand the arrival of pathogens and insects, whether it were gypsy moths or Dutch elm disease. Like, people got it. But the thought that plants could form this sort of ecological pavement, it is really, really, I think, in the last 20 years that people have begun to say, whoa, you know, what's...
And really. And I'd say also the threshold that I see in a lot of presentations, the awareness, you know, as the invasion grows and the curve goes up and up, usually it's at the precipice or at the very top that the awareness, people say, oh, there's a problem. And we're trying to get that awareness way down low into early detection mode so that you can do it. And so instead of $1,200 an acre, it's more like pennies on the acre or something where you're just hand pulling, you know, that plant that's finally, you know, getting in the landscape like species right now. Maybe the genie's out of the bottle for some of them that we were hoping that we could stop, like Japanese stillgrass. But still, I think that's the magic of this work is catching it really early.
Landowners, because we see a lot of people growing burning bush, huge areas next to conservation areas, and what do you do when the seed population is on a private piece of property and you know that? And so I think that definitely has got to be in our development strategy to perhaps create some funding for replacing someone's shrubbery that's invasive, offering some solutions for coordinated removal, but that, I don't think there is a good strategy yet.
They're not allowed to propagate that on their property, but they can grow it on their property. But there are some plants that the state has prohibited.
Yeah, they're on the prohibited list, but they're still growing abundantly all over the place.
I think one thing that maybe we can think about and talk about among ourselves today is what would a citywide Northampton program look like?
To encourage rather than prohibit.
Definitely, yeah. I mean, it involves both awareness, getting people aware of invasive plants, but also enlisting the volunteers to actually do the work. And
you can switch out your shrubs.
You could replace the garden tour with an invasive tour. Wouldn't that be fun?
I can see a lot
pay
of
your taxes and invasive plant biomass. That's my favorite. Pay your taxes and invasive plant biomass. Put a bounty on them. It works for wolves.
This is. Yes. Okay, does everyone know what this is? So we can just keep walking.
Yes, no, and I'm including that.
I'm not looking at you. I'm not looking at you either.
No.
John, I'm probably not looking at you either.
Don't ask me anything. So, Laurie, how did it get so well established? It makes it really nice. Was it ever a garden plant?
The first time I saw it was about 20 years ago. I don't know, it has a prolific seed production.
That's what I heard too.
It was actually brought in the season.
Whether or not that's true.
Garlic mustard is, well, first off,
let me just say I heard this really great thing years ago. I know Bob was there. It was Chris Matrick talking about invasives and the stages of grief. I'll announce that I've fully come to the point of acceptance, the final, most enlightened state of the process. And I do accept them on some level, and a big part of it is picking your battles. Garlic mustard is one of them that I find the most hope towards, you know, when I see garlic mustard, because I know that lots of people can get involved. I also really deeply believe that a lot of people should get involved with invasives and garlic mustard. And there's a great kind of fun competition initiative through a group called the Stewardship Network, and they're really encouraging people to get out there and compete, form competition. So Northampton could have different organizations. You could bring the competitive American spirit or human spirit into the mix, and you know, you're weighing your bags and recording that, and then submitting that, and then you've got different clusters that are all trying to out-pull each other. Garlic mustard is also one that's a little bit funny on a management perspective. We're not all in unison that we should even be doing anything about it. And one of our leaders, a really wonderful researcher named Bernd Blossi from Cornell University, told us, gosh, I guess we're going on 6, 7, 8 years now. And he just sort of came out of the woodwork and said, well, my research shows that garlic mustard isn't here to stay, that, you know, basically the population blinks on very high and then it just naturally dissipates. I have yet to observe that personally, but I guess that is somewhat encouraging that his research is demonstrating that, but I have yet to see that research.
Why would that be? What would the mechanism be that it would peak and then go down?
I'm sure there's an answer, but I don't have it.
Yeah, and I think it's really important to like take note. Okay, that's what he found. But for instance, when most of us think about moose, right? Where do we imagine them in a setting, right? Where is it?
High elevation,
but like when you see the photograph of the moose, where are they?
Water, in the marsh.
And the data here in Massachusetts, radio collar data, that's not at all the case. They're in areas, shelter wood cuts, places like that have been cut, everything's springing back up, and they spent almost no time in wetlands. So, that's right. So that's one of the sites where they have the animals collared. And not with radio collars, with GPS tracking, so they really know exactly where they're going, how long they're going. So, you can observe something in one setting that may or may not be the case. One of the things that's really not helping us is the increase in deer. And it turns out there's a great researcher at UConn and associated with the Connecticut Ag Station, a guy named Scott Williams. And for his PhD, his advisor said, well, how about if we get some deer poop and we grow it in the greenhouse? And he thought, great idea. And it turns out that if many of the seeds of invasives pass through deer and they emerge and they are fully capable of germinating and sprouting, in contrast to many native species, which are digested and become non-viable. So, and as deer have, as you all know, really increased. This is a nice site because we have a few examples where there's not much of something. But I suspect that that garlic mustard is one of those, just to jump back to garlic mustard, that passes through here and is shed. But there must be other vectors, because on my own property, I've been really trying to limit it, and it appears a new site. So I think somebody's eating it and depositing it in new locations on my property. But
just a very basic question about garlic mustard. If you break it off and don't get the root out, is that root going to do anything?
It's a fascinating plant, yes. So I've done everything there is to do to it, torture-wise. And what I found is that even if you were to hand-pull garlic mustard and set it out somewhere, it'll continue its trajectory. It'll still produce seed. If it is flowered, if it's before flowering, it'll stop. But if it has flowers, it'll continue to produce seed, probably not as much seed, much viable seed. But I've also found that you can weed whack it twice in a season in the shade and control it that way, but your timing has to be spot on. So with invasive plants, you have to have a really astute eye for timing, and there are sites that can help you understand the phenology of when you should be there. And then, of course, it's going to vary a little bit every year depending on the rainfall and the heat and such. But I think that you can certainly hand pull it to great effect. It's all about preventing seed set. And that's the most important thing because it's a biennial.
And each plant could make up to 8,000 seeds. We just had a control at a volunteer day at Mass Audubon, which I should have said I'm also representing Mass Audubon. It's a biennial, but they can go more than two seasons. So the first year it makes a rosette. We've got the little seedlings here. They're tiny.
Basically, what Chris is standing on and everything behind is all seedlings.
So it makes a rosette the first year, gets through the winter. Again, brought over as a medicine, and believe it or not, I heard that it was also brought over to control erosion. And it also, in the literature on the web now, the literature said that it doesn't tolerate acid soils well, so that's maybe why it's not too much here in our higher hills with the rocky substrate. They're blueberry barrens, that's acid soil. Garlic mustard shouldn't get a hold, but they've also done studies at Harvard Forest looking at the leaky roots of these plants that inhibit the growth of mycorrhizal fungi, may inhibit the growth of regeneration of forest species. Again, this whole family, Brassicaceae, even though it includes the type genus Arabidopsis, the most studied plant in the world, it doesn't form mycorrhizal associations. It's kind of unusual. 85% of species do. This plant doesn't. It may be doing this underground chemical warfare that's very difficult to study, but it hasn't been totally eliminated.
Yeah, but so simply hand-pulling it, I think, is a really great strategy, and preventing it from coming from, typically gets started on the road edges and tries and starts to move in, and keeping it at bay. I'm dealing with 40 acres of just wall-to-wall garlic mustard at Greylock Glen in the Berkshires, and that's tough to do. And then there we're using chemicals, and we have been able to reduce it by 90%, but there's always something to come back to a point where you can start to hand pull it. But I would say, generally, when I see really big infestations, I'm looking more towards containing them, the satellite, and keeping them as one unit. Not ignoring them, but just going for the plants, not going directly, you know, our human nature is to go right into it. But I don't think that's a good idea with invasives for the most part. Think about prioritizing and just keeping the satellites at bay, at least at first.
Protecting on the edge of getting into natural areas.
That's right.
Okay, we're not... Just to take it home with what you were saying about the seed on the garlic mustard, because it's kind of an easy one to organize volunteers for. Yeah. It's a gratification kind of plant. So what you're saying is if you're organizing that event, because it's blooming and so it's easily identifiable by the non-plant people, it has to get into garbage bags. It's not adequate to make a pile of pulled, blooming garlic mustard.
That's correct.
You've got to cook it.
That's right.
You have to check at the the stage.
That's right.
So you're handing your volunteers black plastic garbage.
You are, yes.
Go out and put it into.
That's right. Yeah. And you can get into other forms of other bags, like leaf bags, but then you have to be dedicated to burning it, which often is not possible. It is where I live. Brush burning tradition is alive and well. So I take a lot of bags home with me and burn them. And then I have a little bit of garlic mustard around the fringes of my bonfire to deal with the next year. But I think that disposal is probably the most responsible. It just goes directly into the landfill, unfortunately.
Yeah, think of it as garbage.
Or incinerated.
It's not compost, it's garbage.
Exactly, right.
Does the city of Northampton have any arrangement for accepting that, or is it basically...
It's a bag of garbage.
Yeah.
You know, like anything. Trash. Yeah.
You have to bring it out to Glendale Road.
You can get quite a bit in there. So there you have it.
But when you say you're burning it at home, you just pull that stuff out of the bags and then
no,
torch
I just,
it?
I put it right in here, in these leaf bags.
Oh, okay. Oh.
And my kids and I do an awful lot of pulling garlic mustard. It's really quite fun. Relax it. Put it right in here and it'll dry, whereas in here it'll turn really moist and kind of gross. Here it'll just dry out and get brittle. And then you need to staple this and then take it to your burn pile.
So what do you use that one for?
This one?
Yeah.
This would just be a volunteer work day where you don't have the opportunity to burn it.
Oh, I see.
But
I
this
see.
Is just... Because getting it out of this, you'll spread the seed and all that. Yeah. So I'd say either option, but if you do have the ability to burn it, then put it in paper, and you can just toss it right on the fire.
Yeah, that's beautiful. So someone was really helping. So is everyone familiar with this? This you are. You all are. This is.
I have a ton of it. I have no idea what it is.
This is at every Burger King and McDonald's. This is burning bush.
That's a good name.
And it's also known as winged euonymus. This one is so tiny, it's not very winged, but you can see these corky margins here. Yeah. But it's a beautiful plant. But here's what's interesting. Is it?
Wait, it's a beautiful plant for 2 weeks.
Yeah, wait. Yeah. Okay. For 2 weeks, it's very pretty. It has this. It's called burning bush because in the fall, the leaves turn this brilliant scarlet red. It is a relatively new invader in terms of coming in the 1960s and 70s when people began to say, "Oh, it's naturalizing. It's escaping the garden." But it's one which you see in Northampton in various locations, and you see a ton of it in like the Manhan River, or like the old in the area of the old Mill River Channel. There's a lot of privet there, and there's also quite a bit of this. But where it's really bad, like this. This is a site here in the Mineral Hills. These hills are a little bit more calcium neutral, and there's some very interesting plants up near the top. And this shrub is spotty up there. And if you go up on like Mount Tom, in my hometown, it's Trap Rock Ridges, and this plant has come in with a vengeance. So it's one that I know there's a little bit at Fitzgerald Lake. There's it's widespread in Northampton, but something that we should.
There's another ID trick with euonymus. It has opposite leaves. It's very easy to see that opposite leaf pattern. Most plants have alternate leaves, not all, but opposite's a little bit unusual.
How tall does this get?
Mature?
Oh, it can get bigger than that. Yeah. My neighbors have
some. Yeah. Yeah. The forest, like this.
Right, in the shade where you typically see it in the shade. The landscape plant can get, a cultivated one could get 12 by 12 or something like that. But out here, it's going to be an understory, more thin. shrubby.
I mean, it's widespread in Northampton. Down in West Springfield at the conservation area there, it's like a thicket. It's intense. So, any other information
just
about
that
removal?
Be prepared for a lot of seedlings.
Yeah, it has this rain shadow of seeds. Unbelievable. You can really see that down in the river beyond the Smith treatment area. There's some places where it's just
and
lousy.
Birds really like the berries.
I don't know that they really like them, but they eat them.
Yeah, 10 feet up to 20, according to this.
Come on. They also put out a guidebook, and they have the lookalikes of native species. And it's nicely done. And the other thing that I appreciate about that is in thinking about climate warming, you can see the next time you head south on 91, there is so much tree of heaven or ailanthus. It's the tree that was in, the tree grows in Brooklyn. That's what's outside her fire escape. But I feel like in the last 20 years, that's a species that's really marched to the north. Now, I was telling some other people, I've been reading these journals of Sylvester Judd, and in 1848, their ailanthus, tree of heaven, was planted here in Northampton at the what's now known as the Lyman Estate. And so it's been here a long time, but it's really in the last 20, 30 years. I mean, it was brought, like so many of these were brought over for horticultural reasons, 1860s, 1870s, very typical. A handful of them really heavily promoted at different times. But so anyway, that's our one example today, as far as I know, of burning bush.
There's another one right over here.
Great.
For your next walk, there's another one.
All right, we'll get that one before we leave. Just ignore this. Oh, it's this. Jeez, I didn't think this was here. Dang. Dang, but I guess helpful for this. So this is the first one on our list. So I was driving here and I was thinking, and you're like, you look through this new filter, you say you're going to lead a walk about invasives, and how? Where are they? And I thought, well, if you find Norway maple, which is what this is, it's very similar to sugar maple, but it's a little bit darker green, a little bit broader. And if we'll find a sugar maple, like here. How convenient, how convenient.
Like sugar.
This one secretes a milky sap. That's one, like a really great character. And then, if you contrast it with this sugar maple, it's broader. And this one has, see these veins coming out? This has like 5 to 7 veins, whereas this one has 3 to 5. And don't, you know, size doesn't necessarily matter here. This is a function of other factors. But the best character is that milky sap on a Norway maple versus a clear sap, basically none, on a sugar. And this is a species which is heavily promoted. It happened to be in the nurseries when Dutch elm disease swept through. And so that's why you see it so commonly planted in urban settings and along neighborhoods, because all the elms were coming down, people were alarmed, and so lo and behold, happened to be thousands available at that moment in local nurseries.
And they're super urban tolerant.
Yeah.
They're sturdy bastards. So yeah, they're a great street tree in that sense.
Except not so great if you live in Worcester.
And because they're susceptible to ALB.
Asian longhorn beetle.
I have a good trick for Norway because I do this with students. They get a bright yellow fall color and they hold their leaves longer than the sugar maples. So if you do Norway eradication in the fall, you can wait till a lot of the leaves are down and just send a bunch of clueless volunteers to get seedlings with yellow, it looks like a maple tree, bright yellow fall color, persistent, holding their leaves longer. So that's another one of those timing things. You can't say, oh, that's on October 25th. But if you're watching Fall Color, the sugars will drop before the Norway's will, and it's bright yellow. So.
And as a classic example, this is probably perhaps familiar to many people, it is a species that flowers earlier than the native sugar maple. There are other red maple, silver maple are also flowering, but these have pretty large yellow flowers that are more like in a cluster. And earlier this year, I mean, driving in Northampton the last week of April, again, just like in the fall, you could just say, there's one. Very much an edge specialist, but creeping into more sensitive areas, I would say, like some of our riparian forests. But this is a surprise to me because I was driving and I was thinking, okay, well, we're not going to see that because it's like downtown Northampton, you know, in the neighborhood. But sorry.
Fair enough. Here they are. This is also a really good, obvious one for explaining the problem with invaders because they occupy they're starting to occupy the niches of the sugar maples. It's really low-hanging fruit in terms of the story. It's very clear to somebody that we'd rather have sugar maples than Norway maples for many, many reasons, including how economically important sugar maples are in New England. And so if you can't let the Norways take over the ecological niches for the sugars. We need the sugars, and humans need the sugar maples, not, you know, for our leaf tourism, for our sap industry, all those kinds of things. Yes, exactly.
Oh, yeah, I was going to talk about management on these. These Norway maples and Tree of Heaven and Black Locust, depending on your views or your management priorities for Black Locust, what I often advocate for is just simply girdling these trees in the woods. Of course, as conservation land managers, you may need to take the tree down if it's near a trail, but just to create snags, in the woods, simply by girdling, doing the full girdle two times, works on Norway maple. Ailanthus is a little different. You have to do either a hatchet cut or a chainsaw cut, give 2 inches of space, and then another one, and then go around the circumference of the tree that way to prevent it from resprouting. But I like doing this because you don't need to use chemicals on these trees to effectively kill them, and then you can leave them as placeholders as a wildlife snag, which is a win-win.
Chris, how wide is the band when you girdle it? Any width when you girdle those?
Any width.
Inch wide around it will do it.
Yes.
How far from the ground?
About at your diameter at breast height is a good place to start. And then
for me, it just keeps sending new sprouts up from the ground.
Oh, okay. And are you doing two?
No, I just cut the tree off and keep hand yanking all the sprouts off, and it just keeps sending new sprouts.
Oh, well, the double girdle, and we're talking about Norway people. The double girdle somehow seems to take care of it. And there are special devices. You can also use a hatchet or a knife. And then, if it's small like this, you can use a weed wrench, or you can cut it and dab herbicide, which I'll show you later.
For those of you who don't know, John was mentioning that there was some rock quarrying here. This area has been, we were above the level of Glacial Lake Hitchcock here. But there were some sand deposits, little outwash deposits. There may have been, some little lips. So back in the early 1950s, that's when sand removal operations began in this area.
By
then, known as the Omastas. Some of you may know the Omastas. Their descendants are still in this West Farms area. And then the land was sold in the early 80s, the new owner discovered ledge not too far below some of these sand deposits, so began some small quarrying operation. And then when that land was sold to the next person, the next owner wanted to do much, much more significant and began much more blasting, and so that was the beginning of a lot of focus. I first came here when there was a rock quarry in about 1985, and we'll soon be there. For how many people have not ever been here before? All right, so this is one that you probably all know. This is multiflora rose, but I wanted to. Does everyone know this plant? We'll pass it around.
Smells beautiful. Oh, I love it.
It's one. Too bad I was so kind of penny wise, pound foolish. Years ago, and probably you can find it on eBay, there was a government publication describing what a terrific plant this was.
Oh, I have it.
You have it from the 1945
yeah,
or something
yeah,
like that?
Yeah, I have it. It's a Mass Agricultural College.
Okay, well,
put it out.
Okay.
I'll give it to you for Historic Northampton.
Well, anyway, the thing is, it's just saying, you know, and don't worry because the seeds aren't viable and it's going to be this great living fence and it's just the berries, right? So anyway,
great. Right. So just to amplify that, it was advocated to farmers in Massachusetts as a great
all over,
not just Massachusetts, but this is a mass publication as a living fence to maintain pastures and cattle. Instead of fencing, you could just plant this multiflora rose and its wonderful wildlife habitat, and your cows won't eat it. So it's a natural fence, gets about 12 feet tall. What could be better?
About to flower, and it has at the end has this. Cluster of flowers, of white flowers. There's many native roses. And the other things that you could potentially confuse it with is here's a large blackberry, right? This is a slightly different five-parted. Right? And then this is native raspberry down here. So you have to be careful. Sarah LaValle and I have been cutting this recently at Parsons Brook, which is a very, very, very pretty fertile wetlands, and it hasn't been as bad as I thought because the plants are big, and so we're able to go in. But the challenge is when you cut it, if you don't, maybe Chris, jump on in, but if you don't cut it, it will resprout. And the other thing, it has the capacity, if, like, I've been cutting it at my own property, and then this being held by the bittersweet, it lays down in the wetland areas, and roots establish here, and I've got more. So you can't just cut and leave in place and think, that's done, but it's a prolific resprouter. Any other?
What about control? I've got great news. There's a disease called rose rosette disease. I just pulled up the email from Christian Marks at the Nature Conservancy.
Yeah.
I'm seeing it all over the place.
Yeah.
Don't see it here, but he's so gung-ho
optimistic
on this disease that he thinks that we should
move on.
Sort of temper our enthusiasm for controlling rose and let nature, this disease, do it within, say, 10 years. Unfortunately, it won't be selective just on multiflora rose, but I am really seeing this in various parts in my town. I live near Turner's Falls, Greenfield area, and I'm seeing it there. I'm seeing it in Longmeadow.
Are you seeing it? I heard that the one worry with that is that it's like in open, disturbed settings, but for instance, at Fitzgerald Lake or some of our other large conservation areas where you think, okay, we don't really have to worry. In fact, multiflora rose is one of the species that you find in these interior wetlands. Are there any data about?
I don't know.
This is the mite born.
This is
mite.
This is rose
rosette.
And it's a
virus.
Native RRD is native to the Rocky Mountains, and multiflora rose is very susceptible to it. Our native eastern North American roses are completely resistant to RRD, so I misspoke, excuse me. However, horticultural roses are susceptible, and consequently RRD is not allowed to be moved around as a biological control. Anyway, I have a couple of papers on it from Christian that I can share with folks. But every once in a while, there's a little bit of news.
Actually,
we found in a couple of places that we haven't really gone after multi-spotted rose too avidly. But in a couple of places, we dug them out, and we haven't had any reinfestation. It seems to be the only effective way of getting rid of them.
They're just almost 100% coverage at the Fort River, or the new land at Hadley there. It's just horrible there. And maybe one reason cultivated roses are susceptible is because this plant was used in breeding programs to get that multi-flora habit. Most roses are born singly, solitary, or in small branching clusters, not in this huge raceme that we see in multi-flora rose. So that's how it entered in.
Yeah, it was actually the rootstock that was brought here for roses, not the pasture piece. The pasture piece came later.
I'm using a number of techniques on rose, though, effectively. Of course, foliar applications are effective with glyphosate herbicide. I'm also using stump grinding. So go in and cut it and then stump grind into the ground a little bit as a non-chemical approach, and that's working. And then farmers have been just telling me for years, and I haven't really believed them, but they have a lot of harder knowledge. That's simply not just mowing, but basically, what's the procedure? It's almost like a disc harrow, but really disturbing the soil, knocking it out of the system. As long as you don't just cut it, because it will resprout, but as long as you go through and pull it out to some degree or till it in to some degree, tends to work. So I think there's a lot of hope for rose now that we have this disease as well. But it does bite back, so you never really come out of a venture with rose without drawing some blood.
Although, I'm so sorry, I picked a thornless sport that arose in my yard. I'm really sorry I ripped that one out. So I think that would have perhaps potential for wreath making for crafts, because it appeared to be thornless, or prickleless, I should say.
Lori, back to rubus species. Is this blackberry a native?
Yeah.
And
yeah, these
so
are two natives.
Do we have issues with Himalayan blackberry in mass?
No.
There's one rubus that's prohibited. Okay. It's on the list. And I don't know.
Well, there's lineberry.
Okay. That may be.
But I think that's only unlikely invasive. But it's not one for Northampton that I haven't seen it anything else spreading in the landscape. I'm just gonna, be parochial.
Yeah.
So, Connie's down there for a little bit of scale. she's a little bit lower.
I'm working on my pan pipe. These can be made into flutes. Enough for every school children child in the Commonwealth.
In the Commonwealth. Let me see that, Connie. Okay, well, that's a use I haven't heard.
But they work.
Anyway, this is a species, maybe Chris or Gabby or other people in this group have done this before, but this year I started photographing to see the rate of growth. And in mid-April, I'm using a population on the way to Northampton High School, because I happen to go there once a day during the school week. And it's grown, there's one, most of them are only about our height at this point, so in basically 5 weeks, it's gone from nothing to, there's one that's I think eight or approaching 9 feet.
What is that plant again?
That's Japanese knotweed.
Japanese knotweed.
So what I would love to do next year, maybe we could all do it, we can have a contest. Who has the fastest growing knotweed, right? And because one thing, okay, so this is the group that, and I don't know how far in advance it is, but I thought it would be really fun to have an exhibit at Forbes Library in their gallery of herbarium specimens of invasive plants that people should look at. And yeah, it's hard to see something two-dimensionally and understand it. But wouldn't it be cool, maybe Smith or someone else has the capacity to get like a full knotweed, right? Wouldn't that be just the greatest thing in a art exhibit to have this giant arching stem? People would get it. This is bad.
You can make a film.
Yeah, time lapse film would be fantastic from that guy.
And just have a measuring stick, so you can see. Mm-hmm. But because I didn't do it, but I bet like overnight, literally in that 24-hour period, some of these are.
Yeah.
So.
Lori, NCTV is at Northampton High School. Maybe we could go over there and film it.
Oh, great.
Set up a time lapse.
Great. Yeah. That would be so.
Yeah.
Terrific.
Stop in sometime. Knock on the door.
All right. Well, anyway, this is a species which you're all familiar with. You've got plenty on your property. It's a species that really has dramatically increased in the last 30 years. When I worked in my hometown, a woman came and said, "What is this behind in my parking lot?" And I had never seen it before. And now I drive through my hometown and it's widespread. And you certainly see it here in Northampton in terms of its abundance and other people. Basically, you need about that much, 5 grams, to establish a new population. So I suspect that one of the things that's going on, aside from these river corridors, where like Irene was terrible in Franklin County, it ripped those disturbed, the soil, and spread little pieces of Japanese knotweed all throughout that watershed. And but here it might have been the trucks going back and forth, but I think a lot of it along the roadside edges is from plows taking little pieces and potentially depositing it. They're infertile. Apparently the seeds are not viable, so it's all clonal. But it was imported into America, but already Europe had brought it in, and people in Europe said, "Don't do it." But a little like English sparrows, which also the United States was told, "Don't do it," didn't listen. But in Europe now, maybe some of you saw the article, I think it was in Vanity Fair, where in England, mortgage banks will not issue mortgages if you have this on your property because of the structural issues. Because the roots, we see this and we think that's bad, but that's only a third of the plant. The roots are coming, as you know, maybe not here because we have this gully, but much, much more extensive. So,
and deep.
Yeah.
Like atypically. I mean, just to amplify what you're saying about the root mass, not only are they spreading laterally, but it's a very, very deep-rooted species. There's a tremendous storage bank of energy down there in the root system, which is why no matter what you do to the tops, it's just, "Thank you, sir, may I have another."
And you know, one plant can produce 200 stems.
So when you said this much of it, do you mean of that
underground
mass?
Yeah, like if you thought, "Oh, I'm going to get this." Right?
No, I Googled it before we started messing. Yeah. But we've been mowing it.
Yep.
But I'm worried that is spreading it. If we're just mowing the top.
Yeah. No, but it can, like if you took a whole pile of it and put it in the back of your pickup and then, you know, dumped it over on Bob's property. From the nodes.
Too near.
Okay. I just want to make sure we're not spreading it by mowing it. We're just controlling it.
Yeah.
Right. He's talking about the underground part.
The modified roots or stems
that are underground that can, if you rototill it, you propagate it.
It's very woody.
So are you talking, Chris, about painting it, cutting, and painting with glyphosate?
You can do it that way, yes.
And how effective is that?
Very effective. The only thing is each stem has to be, well, let's see, there's a stem injection procedure, which is great. But you have to stem inject each and every stem, so it's laborious. And you have to use a lot of herbicide. So it's 5 milliliters of herbicide in each cane, which really adds up. So it's much more herbicide intensive than a foliar application, for example. And then a stem like this couldn't be stem injected. You would barely be able to get any herbicide in there because it's a very small plant. But there is, there's so much to say about this plant. There is research to indicate that you may have done something
positive by just pulling this young plant. You have 2 years to get at a newly established washed down the river population or plant that's come up on the roadside to effectively hand pull it. And then after that, it's too immersed and deep to effectively pull. But I thought that was interesting. That was a result of Hurricane Irene. Some research in Vermont showed that you could pull it for 2 seasons and it would be effective.
So in other words, this is an important early detection species, is that you want to get these right when they're popping up. Not, it's going to be a totally different kettle of fish when it looks like this.
It'll be very different.
I don't find 1 year as adequate on what you're describing in terms of stem injections. That's been our experience at Smith.
Okay.
Is that it may be effective, but that you're going to have to do that multiple times to the population.
That's
to
right. Kill stem it. Injection and then the cutting and dripping. As well, and it becomes to a point where you have to just sort of, you know, figure out what you're doing where and be consistent. Generally, I'm using that on the water course, the stem injection. But you can only use the stem injector when the diameter of the stems are half an inch or larger. So then you're forced to stem inject all the big stems and then inject the herbicide and the others. There's also another promising technology that's a rhizome injector, but that's not available yet. It's being developed. And then the most efficient way, though, is to cut the knotweed in June and then let it resurge. And by the time you get to the flowering season in mid-August, thereabouts, then you can do a foliar application. However, herbicide applications done before mid-August or before flowering are ineffective. So that's the other, I don't know if it's
Achilles
heel.
Why do you have to cut it? You have to cut it and then let it grow back?
Because otherwise it's going to be, you know, 9 feet tall.
It's too tall, and it just makes it so that if you cut it, let it resurge, then it's about this tall, and you can do a foliar application.
And what are you using? Glyphosate?
Glyphosate.
So, because I, years ago at, well, two things, one related to this, which is at UMass, Roy Van Driesch, who some of you may know, they're trying to get permission to release a biological control agent, which has some promise, but, you know, it may be one of those things, like, none of this stuff is eradication, it's all just control and management, and so anyway, that's some potentially positive piece.
So that's some sort of insect or
yeah,
what?
Yeah, it's an insect. Yeah, not a virus. But the other thing is, so like there was some work done in Connecticut where they were injecting Phragmites, and it was it was a systemic, so it was going along the stem and killing sections. But you're not finding that with this? Like you really have to be squirt.
I think so, but you have to think of knotweed as a super organism. It's one plant, so it's tricky when it's in the neighborhood, because if you do something, you need to disassociate it from its network through trenching, and that's why black plastic often doesn't work, because it'll just stimulate the plants to grow outward. So you need to break it, put the plastic down, put rigid plastic, you know, to separate it there, and then that can be effective. But if you treat this, but you don't treat that, over the years it's going to regain its sustenance from the sunlight that's coming on the neighboring knotweed. So you really have to think of it as a whole, as a superorganism, and you've got to get the whole thing out.
Will foliar spraying actually get the rhizomes, at least locally?
It will. It does a great job, but, you know, truth be told, I've never... I can eradicate a small patch with chemicals, but generally you get it to a point where you've controlled it. I can control a patch to 99%, but it persists as little stunted stems that if I give up on it for a few years, it'll come back. So once you're invested in a knotweed control project, you're there, I won't say forever, but for a while, and I'm often doing...
Well, you're there forever because new ones are coming, too.
Yeah, you have to watch that, and then you have to watch what comes in, because my first knotweed project, garlic mustard came in, and that tends any bare ground. But there is some interesting research also from Art Gover, who's a weed scientist in Pennsylvania, and he showed that one herbicide application followed by an aggressive seeding of native species, really tall growing herbaceous species and grasses, was successful. And it didn't eradicate it, but the knotweed struggled to persist. And I find in floodplains, jewelweed will often do the same thing. And it will not necessarily outcompete the knotweed, but it'll create a little bit of fight in there, which is nice to see.
But one of the things, you know, Matt mentioned earlier about the barberry and the public health issue, where there's a higher disease of Lyme disease infected ticks in barberry patches. One of the things about knotweed that's different than many other invasives is that it also has a geological component in terms of the harm it can have on these systems. So the next time you're on Route 2 heading up the Deerfield River or walking along the Mill River, you know, these are systems that historically you'd have ice scour, and these islands would be ephemeral features and changing and moving. And now with knotweed, they're more or less anchored and in place. And so it changes actually river dynamics and the natural geologic processes. Like, they're, most of the other things, they're different. But and you can also, like the Dick said, he liked the term ecological pavement. And here, looking at this stand, you can really see that. This provides, okay, so maybe some rabbit's gonna hide in there, but the architecture of that plant is such that no birds are nesting in there. You might find a little bit of browse from deer, a little bit of browse from a few other things, but basically nobody's eating it. The leaves are basically perfect, except Japanese beetles will eat it. But
it is a honey plant.
Huh?
It's a honey plant, but you won't find knotweed honey because no one would buy it. It's star bamboo or something like that.
Yeah.
They rename it.
There's a neat concept in ecology called an ecosystem engineer. So a beaver is a good example of that, where a non-human species that actually modifies the ecosystem that it's in. And so knotweed is just a really interesting plant example of being an ecosystem engineer, holding riverbanks in place, you know, zero ecological value. That's where Lori's getting this ecological pavement analogy. It's equivalent to paving an area in terms of what you've done to the ecosystem when knotweed's in it. So
I just want to say I just disagree with you on that point. I don't see it as a stabilizing influence.
No, I'm not saying it's stabilized. Well, it's in some settings, armors, but then big chunks can
but
tear
away. But that's
it.
What I've been observing is that it facilitates more dramatic erosion on rivers, in that when you get those really big Irene events or larger events that come every so many years, you've got whole chunks of bank coming down, sloughing off, and it doesn't hold really well. And I think it's, instead of just getting a little nibble out of the bank, which would be natural to some degree, you'll just get this entire chunk that'll go down with all the knotweed, and then the knotweed will reestablish somewhere else.
And
really, that Irene event was really tremendous to see how much more knotweed there is in Franklin County in southern Vermont.
And I will say one last thing, that just yesterday I had a personal tip that knotweed control is possible. There was a reunion alum. She and her husband have been working in the Adirondacks, so she gave me this knowknotweed.org, which I'll give to you, Bob, to circulate around.
They had a big initiative in the Adirondacks.
They've been working at it. She said that they've been able to kind of eliminate it from areas of the Adirondacks.
Using what method?
Is that non-herbicide?
Cutting and spraying. That this woman's husband had the pesticide applicator license and personally doing tens of thousands of stems every season. Large scale.
That would be a good one for
among
the
a lot
River
of different organizations.
So the bottom line on knotweed is that you really have to use herbicide. You're not going to get it. You're not going to eliminate it if you don't use herbicide in some fashion.
You can control it without herbicide, but it's repeated. It's every year. Yeah. You've got to mow it or cut it back. And I definitely see people reducing it by 50, even 90%. But the moment you give up, it'll come back. It'll be there.
repeated mowing, like a lawn situation, yeah. sometimes I try to go in with the herbicide, knock it back, convert an area to lawn for a period of time. But after 4 years on this one site, the repeated mowing every 2 weeks, the knotweed is still persisting.
So we're never going to be able to grow apples on that hill, apple tree, basically. I mean, like, that whole part of our property is just done.
Oh, I wouldn't say that. No, I think you
it's
can...
It's not that big an area, relatively speaking.
I think if you're persist in not knock back, and perhaps the herbicide application, I think that you can, as long as it's part of your management, you know, program every year, and you're mowing it repeatedly.
Okay. My husband's big on herbicides, so I'll leave that
there. There was a really good article in Harper's Magazine last year about the issue in Wales. Knotweed has completely taken over Wales, and they have a very intensive program. It's utilizing steam injection into the rhizomes. I think what Chris is probably talking about, that's not being done here yet, but it had a really good perspective of an ongoing battle, expensive and consuming, time-consuming. It has a really good idea of lapse of time and how much effectiveness they had on a pretty small island.
What do they inject?
I don't know what herbicide it was. It was some herbicide, but the method was a steam injection then into the rhizome.
But at a site like, oh, I'm sorry, Chris.
I was just going to say, back to, I think, Lori's question or comment, I think that you literally could, the chemical companies say that you need to inject every stem. My own, you know, experimentation with it indicates that if you were to treat every a couple of, if you have a clump with five stems and you treat one or two, that you're definitely seeing, in some cases, it's you're getting some resprouts, but in some cases you're getting, that whole clump is gone after the stem injection. So I think more trial could be discovered. And then some research indicates from Peter Dunwitty in the Washington State area that you can cut down that amount to 3 milliliters successfully. Through Nature Conservancy. So there's a refinement, but the literature says 5 milliliters, but when you add it all up, you can only treat, I used to know this number, but it's about 1,000 stems per acre. And typically, you know, a knotweed stand, a well-developed knotweed stand could be many thousands of stems per acre.
So, and like for thinking about the stewardship of conservation areas here in Northampton, you know, where are our priorities on the Mineral Hills? Is that worth our time and energy and money? You know, so these are the more complicated management questions.
But this is also just sort of the worst kind of knotweed infestation, because it got here most likely via something, ignorance, you know. It was fill. It was, that's typically how upland invasives, it's the magic dirt pile that goes from this roadside to that roadside. I just had our Department of Public Works, our highway department, dump on my property an upcoming garlic mustard. It's so infuriating. But at the same time, it's the reality. You have to work with the road crews and everybody. I mean, it really does mean you have to communicate with your neighbors and everybody who's managing the roads, etc. Yeah.
No, that happened to us this winter. We got a deposition of garlic mustard right along the road.
It happened in Leeds with the rail trail, where they brought in, you know, they cut things down and they brought in soil, and it was just wall-to-wall garlic mustard.
Probably happening at Beaverbrook, too, because of the density along the road.
Well, okay. So in a stand like this, which, you know, seems to be relatively contained at this point, would you say it was worth removing it, worth treating it, getting rid of it, or will it remain isolated to some extent?
I think it would be. It's spreading over here a bit.
Right.
It would just be cutting it in June and then doing a foliar application in August, and that would reduce it by 95% if it was well done, and then it's maintenance with chemicals, backpack sprayer, follow-up. So it would be very doable. It wouldn't be absolutely eradicated, but over time it could be. So it'd be, you know, as a conservation land manager, you'd have to be committed to this spot. But if you hired a contractor to come in and do that, for example, it would be very realistic to do the upkeep
you know, with a volunteer or a land steward, because literally it would take perhaps an hour to do this, and then it would take 5 minutes to do the follow-up. So, you know, using, you know, a company or a contractor, but then building a program so that you don't have to rely on them is a really good way to go sometimes. But this wouldn't be beyond anybody's ability, just simply cutting and then foliar applying the glyphosate.
If you cut it, would you just leave that?
Leave it. Yeah, yeah, just leave it. I mean, you could remove it, but it wouldn't make any sense to do it except for aesthetics.
So, Chris, do you think that there's a number of stems on this side? Do you think that's the roots coming under and now moving up? So it's getting all along this floor here.
That'd be my guess. And I don't think it's established on the trail because of the trampling, the disturbance, but I think it's this superorganism that's creating this new superorganism. But it probably will stick to the margins. I wouldn't think it's going to penetrate into the forest.
All right, let's go. We're just going to see three or four more exciting ones.
Have you heard knotweed was investigated as animal fodder?
This will be the superhero part of the horror movie.
Maybe we don't know about it when we investigate, but I knew it was a really good thing.
Is this a familiar shrub to many people? What's going to be fun for those of you who are learning a handful of new species, as you drive home today, you'll think, oh, yeah, there's some of that. Mm-hmm. There's some of that. This is autumn olive. You can eat the fruits, but this is interesting in that some other species are like this, where as a pollinator cue, the white flowers are the ones that have more nectar, and then as they yellow, for our eyes they're yellow, I don't know what an insect view would this be, but this is the cue, like, okay, these yellowy ones, they're not worth visiting. So a lot of different kinds of bees use this. It has some nodules that are, that help fix nitrogen. So it was heavily promoted for erosion control in the 30s and 40s, and it's able to establish in sandy settings and, you know, disturbed edges. But from a habitat ecological point of view, we would be worried about this coming in these sort of sandy barrens. And although we are now heading toward the old quarry site and the old gravel pit, these are interesting habitats. Here in Northampton, if we could go back 400 years, about 10% of our landscape was sand barrens and pitch pine forests. And those, because they're sandy and flat, they're all either old deltas or glacial outwash plains, they make it very easy to either form gravel pits and then become landfills, or they're flat and level and they can become, not here, but up in the Montague Plains, airports, or industrial parks. But here, it's mostly gravel pits and housing developments. There are relatively few patches now of pitch pine barrens and anything that's a sandy barren. We don't have Native Americans or, you know, use fire as an important tool. And so these were, if you look at the old maps, like the 1831 map for Northampton, you see these references to different plains, they're called. And these were these open landscapes, basically sandy barrens. So we have a few cultural grasslands in Northampton, and this is the danger in these old gravel pits or cultural barrens. This thing can come in, and we have a gravel pit near our house, and it was a gravel pit and then a log landing, and there hasn't been any logging done, and it's solid of this stuff. And these have some kind of silvery
undersides of the leaves. They form these orangey red berries. They're feasted on by starlings and robins. But that silvery look on the underside is helpful to recognize this with this autumn olive. And it has some thorns too, which sometimes it makes it more challenging to.
Lori, why do you suppose this isn't more prolific in here? Why hasn't it multiplied?
I don't know. It's curious. There are a handful in here, but it's not. It's if we go into the quarry itself, you'll see some more. But it's another one which, you know, in disturbed settings like, I don't know, malls and places like that along the marginal edges, you see it. But
I wonder if gravel pits are exporting it in loads of gravel.
Yeah, well, I think really mostly it's bird dispersed.
Okay.
And other mammals too.
I think it's the Russian olive related that has the thorns more than.
This does have them though. We don't have a problem. There's another one called Russian olive, which we don't have. It's occurring here.
It smells better. Okay. We'd know it if that was a Russian olive. Very heavy perfume.
It smells like gingerbread, actually. It smells very nice.
Okay, you're on. How to get rid of this thing.
What can I add to it? I think just it's multi-stemmed, so it is hard to weed wrench.
You can use a tool called a honeysuckle popper, but they typically are very stout with their multiple stems. Oh, and I realized the other thing I wanted to mention was just to be sensitive to the timing when you're doing invasive species work, because during the nesting season, that could be a delicate time for nesting birds and pollinators. The other thing with knotweed, a nice thing about cutting it in June is that by the time it flowers in August, everything else is flowering. The knotweed that you cut generally is not flowering, but it's still an effective time to do the chemical application. But the bees love the knotweed as they do the olive. So if you're obviously spraying at that time, you just want to be sensitive and to break so that up, the blue dye in here. But I do have some brush begone concentrate in here. So the way this technique works, all I need for this particular tree is to cut it about 6 inches off the tree, off the ground, that is, with a nice sharp felco or some other type of pruner. And I like to keep it a little bit on the high side so that I have an opportunity if this were to sprout back, which if I didn't put enough herbicide on here, you might get some sprouting occurring here. So it would give me another shot at it to come down below and do a stump treatment. And then all I need to do at this point is apply around the stem just the cambium layer, but on small stems, and the cambium layer is the layer on the outside of the plant that will draw the herbicide in. This method is particularly effective in the fall when
things
are going down, but it's not impossible. The only time you shouldn't use it is in the spring. So we're over that period right now, sap season, so late February through mid-April is a good time to avoid using this technique. Hmm. And then if I have blue dye, that'll prominently show right here. And that's it. And then we can move on to the next plant.
Where do you get that
plant.
Buckthorn blastless, Chris?
It's from a really nice little company called LandscapeRestoration.com in the Midwest. And it's a woman named Cheryl, I forget her last name. And you can purchase these. Like I said, this is what my crews use. They do stand up, and you can replace the sponges, and it's just very discreet, and it's really easy to keep it in your, you know, in a side pocket of a pair of work pants, something like that. And I have not found that they spill, except when, of course, my crew is tossing them to each other. Then, you know, you need to stop that. That's a little too much for this piece of equipment. But I like it. They're affordable. They're very user-friendly. So I would...
And they recharge those with your own stuff?
Yeah, so you add your own chemicals
to
it.
So what she's selling is simply the bottle.
That's right.
It's an applicator.
Oh, that's right. Okay.
Okay. And you can put whatever you want in it.
But she does also sell, I'm just going to come over to this one here. She does sell the Roundup Pro Concentrate in very small bottles and the blue dye. Now this one's a little bit too big for my Felco pruner. This is a saw. If anybody's interested, they have a website. You can buy it directly on the website. Just look for Buckthorn Blaster in the search, and you'll get it right away. And of course, having flagging on all of your equipment in these situations helps avoid
higher equipment costs.
That's right, losing things. And it's as simple as that. And sometimes you have to find the sweet spot for exactly how much herbicide you need to apply. But for the most part, you can go too light, and that's not a good thing. And then you'll get sprouting, and then next time you learn you have to go a little heavier. But for the most part, with this, you apply a little bit of pressure. You don't need it to pool on the plant, but you just need enough coverage. Usually, you don't have to have it go down the stem of the plant or anything like that. So, and my other sort of, piece to this is, in my own practice of doing invasive plant management, I have 100 acres of land, and I really try not to foliar apply herbicide for the most part, and I have them all. I have a lot of barberry in particular. And what I find, not so much in this these conditions, but I find in the forest, if you do a foliar application and just naturally you're going to, if this were your shrub, you're going to have a blank spot all around here. And unless you're willing to plant in there, if you're in a forest, nothing's going to grow there until the next disturbance for the most part. You're on a field edge or something, things will naturally recolonize the area. So it's a different consideration, but it's a bit more laborious. I wouldn't take on 20 acres of, wall-to-wall cork tree this way, but for this type of thing, as Lori's describing, you can look back here and see that you're into a lot of honeysuckle, flowering honeysuckle through here. That may be a different approach, but we have taken on 20 acres of this sort of thing with cut stump method, and it's worked very well.
The other thing that, I don't know how your crew works, but Sarah LaValle and I have just in the last couple of weeks, not one planner, if we had like five people with loppers and Sarah has a pesticide license and so she'd be coming tonight, bad idea. Because those stems, they disappear, especially now as the...
Yeah.
You've really knocked that thing back. So, okay, even if she misses it. But working as a team has been great. Where I cut, and then in her case, she has a back... it wasn't a backpack sprayer, but a sprayer. But the nozzle that she has is like a little sleeve. And so for some of the small stuff we're doing, basically, it just goes right over there. Or just like Chris, But as a team, it works great. And, like for your crew, like cut and then bend over. And, it's a lot for one person just physically, but I think also there's that psychological piece that gives you more energy working as a team.
The crew effect.
Yeah.
That's right.
Anyway, I can't tell you. When I came here a couple of years ago, before I knew what this thing was, I thought, what is this? And then when I was here in preparation for today, and I saw it, and I thought, another new site for this. But it's one that I hope we can keep at bay in Northampton. So, and there's another new one, which if you want to, Bob, the other three things that I wanted to show people, which don't have to happen here because they're all next to the parking lot. So we could loop around and does everyone have their lunch?
Could you say the name of this plant?
This is the Amur cork tree, Phellodendron, uninvited in conservation.
Essentially, it goes off to EdMaps. and somebody actually looks at your data and has to approve it for inclusion in the overall EdMAP picture of invasive species in the United States. But that is of some value, and it's sort of like eBird for plants. But it's also a valuable record for yourself, because you can always go back into your upload queue and investigate the data that you put up on, you know, April 15th or May 23rd or whatever. So I don't know. I have a little bit of a personal bias to doing things more simply, of just putting waypoints on a GPS device, which can be manipulated in the way that Chris was talking about. And you can generate maps that way too. But this EdMap system is quite clever. And you can also go to a fuller version on the EdMap, on the EdMaps website. And it actually gives you the opportunity to provide a lot more information about your invasive species, the invasive species that you're looking at. They have a much longer reporting form on the website. And, then you have space for on an iPad or an iPhone. So it's, you know, it's worth playing around with. It's a neat system, and if you just want to, you know, make a quick register of plants that you've seen and where they are, it's very convenient to do in the field, because you can, you essentially do it while you're standing next to the plant. You take its picture, you get its location, you put something on the map that shows where it is.
And if for whatever reason they decide that they're not going to upload it into their site, can you still have access to what you have saved?
Interesting question. I think so. I think it's made it still. It still remains there, but I haven't had enough experience with it myself to really know what the fate is.
Your work, if someone has already gone out and run through their property with a map.
Yeah.
Such as this, and you can put something in your hand.
It's great. And a lot of Natural Resource Conservation Service projects, the USDA agency, they often have maps before these grant programs, and those can be helpful too.
Uh-huh.
They tend to be more general.
Yeah. Yep.
I tend to like to do more specific mapping than what they do. But I'd say any level of mapping is
a starting point. Yeah.
To get started and to figure out how you're going to go about it. And then from there, what's interesting is you can start to look at prioritizing. Only from that mapping exercise can you start to look at the how the plants are occurring and the densities, and make those decisions that, okay, let's bring a contractor in to do those 2 acres. Let's go hand pull around the satellite areas. And you can really come up with good schemes. I think every property really benefits from a map, and all the more so in this case. This property has a forest management plan and mapping done on a very broad scale, so the invasives aren't very specific from the forest management plan, but there's a place for it. So whenever there's a forest management plan, I always use that as kind of the main document, and then start to plug in my maps or somebody else's maps to the document, or refer to the document, adopt their stand numbers and all that.
But just speaking about bittersweet, I don't think we'll see a patch that's been managed back in 2011 here, because there are a couple of patches on the other side that way, and I think we're going to start heading back to the truck so I can give you a demonstration. But what I've been learning the last couple of years from the Nature Conservancy that's been really eye-opening has been really thinking about invasive plants and what they're doing on the landscape, and what is threatening your goals and objectives as a landowner or a land manager. And I think we can all agree that bittersweet is one of the number one invasives that we're concerned about. But I think as I really examine this, I'm mostly concerned with bittersweet growing into trees. Yep. And I'm trying to keep that from growing into trees. And it's not that I'm not concerned about what it's doing on the ground, because, you know, it's going to grow and try to grow into trees again. But if you start to think about it that way, first priority, get out of the trees, and if you can maintain that, then you're doing something very good.
bittersweet in these sort of mats. It's very difficult to hand pull, though it can be done over a course of years, and you're going to do a lot of soil disturbance in the process. The cut and dab method is tedious and slow, but that is generally what I recommend unless they're seedlings and you can pull them discreetly out. You'll see their orange roots and all that. But sometimes I'll just come in and weed whack around the trees and just maintain that every year. And that's the next best thing as far as I'm concerned. Because bittersweet, my understanding is bittersweet will grow into trees and continue to grow, whereas grape will grow much more gradually and won't overtake the tree. It'll grow with the tree, whereas bittersweet will literally just keep climbing up and just cause some problems in the weaken the tree at the time.
Yeah, the principal way it weakens it, is that it grows up and then its weight, let's say in a snowstorm, knocks a branch off the tree, which provides an entry point for pathogens and fungi and things like that. It's not necessarily like a strangler fig, which is actually overtopping and shading out its host tree, but it's weakening that way. And Christian Marks, who Chris has mentioned, he's done some work where if you're a tree and you've got bittersweet, that's not so good. If you're a tree and you have grape, less of a problem. But if you're a tree with grape, you have much higher vulnerability that bittersweet will use that grape vine as a climbing, it's actually worse to have. You're much more vulnerable if you're a tree with grape.
I haven't heard that. That's interesting.
In advertising, do you make it a point to destroy the female vines before the male vines to prevent the seed spread? It is dioecious.
That's far more sophisticated than I've got. Okay. That sounds good. I'll be thinking about it.
That's the first thing in my yard, you know. Those beautiful fruits. You know, if somebody wants bittersweet vines to use in decorations, they have to sign something that say they will not let the seed out into the wild.
But one thing I have noticed just on my own property, which has been kind of fun and somewhat horrifying, I call it the landmine concept. Invasive plants, but in particular bittersweet, the seed will get into a forested area and they'll be tiny, barely recognizable. I think I'm anthropomorphizing perhaps, but I think they're waiting, you know, for that disturbance, the light, the tree to come down, and then they're coming up in those little light gaps. And so I'm finding those light gaps on my property, and if you get there early enough, you can really do something about it, cutting and treating the stems and all that. But now what I'm doing is I'm going in, or I'm debating whether I should be actually going in and pulling all of those little seedlings. And literally they are, you know, there may be one here, here, here. They're just perfectly peppered, ready for that forest disturbance, and then they're going to get in there.
Well, and in an area far end of the Mineral Hills, there's a section of hemlock forest where the hemlock has really belted, so dying out. And there, in that much now more sunnier environment, it's loaded with bittersweet. And you wouldn't it's in the interior forest. It was a surprise to encounter it. The other one to watch for, I'll just mention before we head down, is swallowwort, which there's quite a bit here on Sylvester Road. It isn't really up yet in a point where you can readily spot it, but for those of you who are going to head home taking Ryan Road, in that point where just before Ryan Road and Burt's Pit Road split, there's a patch where the old road used to go through, and that bank is full of swallowwort. But that's another species which, again, in the last 20 years, more and more, and there's some on Elwell, there's some at several conservation areas where, without attention, it could potentially really take over. Spring Grove Cemetery, where the lupins have just begun to bloom, there's a couple patches in there too.
You'll go home, you'll find it on your property. Some neighbor came to me, what's this plant? It looks like a milkweed, but it's a vine. Like, oh, I hope I don't get it, you know, and then went to the end of his property that was.
Yeah, There's a lot near Pine Street along the Mill River that pro brush and such. It's lousy in there. Anyway.
A tip also with the glossy buckthorn. Always look for, I've just noticed it on my property, just seedlings, and I've been scratching my head. Where is it coming from? Well, I just missed the obvious plant that was putting out a lot of fruit. And in this case, it was only one plant that established in the field edge. And then you cut that, and then you have a couple of years of pulling those seedlings, and then your problem hopefully is solved. So sometimes you will come across mysteries on the land that you have to look a little further to see where the seed production is coming from. With swallowwort, it's a real problem because it's wind dispersed seed. It can come from a long distance. But always go for the seed producers, the most mature plants first. And my premise is that it's always a good idea to cut first and reduce, because it just makes things neater, easier to find, and anything from loppers. Believe it or not, I think these are very effective just for bittersweet, small bittersweet vines. There's also a, here it is. This is the mechanized version of this.
And, hedge trimmers.
Oftentimes you'll have just trees enshrouded in bittersweet that's very thin. And it's much easier and quicker to go through that with this. In fact, this would be the tool. Yep. I would certainly use that just to clean this up and get it out of the trees. There are also mechanized tools such as this. I'll show you the brush saw in a moment that will give you the elevation. So there are pruning saws. They have small chainsaws on them. So you could literally come through and cut all that out and then cut it out at the bottom as well. And then do your herbicide or not. This, I would say, is about my favorite piece of equipment. And it's similar in effect to a chainsaw, but this blade is kind of special. That it's dull right now, but it can be sharpened up. And that could certainly go through pretty much anything. It's called a forest clearing saw or brush saw. And so you could certainly make mincemeat of this entire area, bittersweet. The woody stems are going to be hard to get through, the downed wood. But this keeps a distance, so I like this in rows, because rows can really attack you, and you can get a nice grip and then come at it, cut it, and then back away from it, and then use a potato hook or a rake to pull that rose material. So this new technique I'm starting to use called stump bagging. And you know how there's the buckthorn blaster I showed you? Well, these are buckthorn baggies, and they're essentially mini plastic bags. You cut your buckthorn or any woody shrub. This is a year later after you remove the baggie. I'm working with a group at a site where no chemicals can be used, so we're going to be working with buckthorn baggies to starve the
so that was it just suffocates it or
suffocate no light, no air.
Okay.
No
so it doesn't allow the
right
dormant bugs to sprout.
And then smothering, this is a technique I'm starting to work with more and more with black plastic on field edges or places you want to reduce your herbicide usage, or then you want to introduce seed. I'll tell you how effective it is as I get through a few years working with it.
Probably but depends what on using? What it is you're smothering, right?
And what the object is.
I'm working on it with knotweed on one site and woody's on another. And then we're introducing, so this spring we introduced a cover crop to a site to see if we could outcompete the woodies, if that 1 year of knocking them back would work. It's a 6 mil plastic sheeting. And I haven't found that staples are very effective. I found that sandbags are better.
So that's left in place indefinitely, not reused?
Well, 3 years is its shelf life. Okay. I used something called lumber wrap and it disintegrated on me. It was a bit sad. So I went back to just hardware store grade, and that seems to be holding up very well. And then this other technique that I mentioned earlier, which is stump grinding, shows some promise, but I'll know the results in a little while.
Is it side mounted?
Yeah, that's the way it comes.
It's
very.
What's
the sole
fruit?
Logic of that?
Well, it's made by a group called the Prairie Enthusiasts in the Midwest. And what exactly the law? I think they want to get a little bit of a twist.
Yeah.
I think that's
quite interesting.
Yeah, it is interesting. Yeah. So there's that. I'm just showing you just sort of strange little tools that I've come across. A seed hook, like if you're removing seed heads or purple loosestrife, that sort of thing. This has a nice cutting edge. Or something a little smaller like this is useful and helpful.
Can I ask you, how often are you finding the biological control for purple loosestrife? How effective is it in your experience?
It's effective, I'd say, but you need to replenish every so many years. So down at Fanny Seven's Refuge in Longmeadow, it had been introduced. The beetles had done what they could, and now we have to reintroduce them. But I would say that from the reports that I heard, the loosestrife was down about 50%. And that's what I'm hearing throughout eastern Massachusetts also. That's reduced even further, down to, say, 20% of what it used to be. So it seems to be a good technique, but it's not going to totally eradicate it, of course.
I know it from three conservation areas in Northampton. It's okay. Present, but, you know, one plant looks terrible, and the plant next to it has got multiple flower heads, and in the last 20 years, at the one site where it was introduced in Northampton, the beetle is still present, but the loosestrife is so much more of a problem, but it hasn't been reintroduced for many, many years.
It might just need to be reintroduced. I'm generally not working on loosestrife for that reason, just trying to reintroduce the biocontrol.
Are you treating that with any other methods? Are you chopping off seed heads, or do you loosestrife work?
Yeah, I'm chopping off seed heads for loosestrife, and also phragmites. Uh-huh. If there's a last minute project that we just can't get to, and what we're trying to do is keep up on the literature. And most of what I'm reading is journals such as Ecological Restoration, Restoration Ecology, Natural Areas Journal, and now we have our own new journal called Invasive Plant Science and Management through the Weed Science Society. And so between these four, I can find an awful lot of what I'm looking for. But when I got started, I was looking at the Nature Conservancy's Weed Methods Handbook.
Oh, right.
And that was a great start. And as time goes on, there are always new studies that are coming out and being presented at conferences. Our biggest conference in New England is the CIPWIG, or Connecticut Invasive Plant Conference, that's coming up in October. So that'll be a great source of information.
Are stem injectors just hypodermics, or is there something special?
You can use a hypodermic. The stem injector that I'm using is a more commercial product called the JK Stem Injection System.
It is so commercial.
Yeah, and it's a lot of money. It's a few hundred dollars for one of these units.
The city bought one.
Really? But just to set the stage, I should have started this way. I just wanted to mention that if you cut a plant at regular intervals, say a woody plant, in this case it's huckleberry, which we're not after, but just as an example of a woody plant, what you'll notice is around this time of year, late May, mid-May to early June, everything is putting on leaves and spending a lot of its root reserves. So at this time of year is a great time up till mid-June to whack it. Just do anything in your power to knock it back. And then what's going to happen? It'll resprout and want to put new leaves together. And it's going to spend more energy in that process. So even if you're applying herbicide, the principle is to whack it in the June time frame, let it resurge, spend the energy. Then the herbicide is that much more effective, or can be. Or if you can't use herbicide, or you're just trying to, you know, manage it without herbicides, whack it again about 6 weeks later, because you're going to have a similar effect. And then pretty soon, using those six-week intervals, it's about a month earlier in the season, 6 weeks later in the season, eventually it will give up. And we all have examples of, you know, you did one bad thing to a plant and it never came back. Well, the likelihood of that happening will increase after a couple of years with woody plants.
with some of these things like knotweed, I'm not quite certain it'll ever happen. It stands to reason that it would, but I don't know that for sure. So, but I like to show this with honeysuckle, just this is total available carbohydrate, or the strength of the roots, the energy in the root reserves that can be tested. And so this generally follows a pattern for all woody plants, invasive or otherwise. Oh, I have an exciting one to show you. Let's see, where is that? Does anybody like fire?
Yes.
Okay. So approach this one carefully. This is a spring application. I think someone mentioned, Lori mentioned, Scott, someone another from Connecticut Agricultural Station.
Scott Williams.
And this is probably Scott was in, Scott Williams was involved, but this is Jeff Ward.
Yeah, it's Jeff is the one who did the barberry research.
So there is a great tool which is called the Red Dragon propane torch. Mm-hmm. And I didn't bring the propane canister with me because I'd be tempted to use it. And today wouldn't be a good day. So you need to do this in the earlier part of the season when it's very moist. And this actually works on Japanese barberry. It's about 60% efficacy versus, well, if you just cut it, it wouldn't be much. I've experimented on this. I do like the technique, though. I wouldn't say I've achieved 60 yet. I still think I'm doing the technique wrong. But you,
did you cut it first?
Well, if the plants are big, you are supposed to mow it or cut it.
Yeah.
If the plants are small, then I think you can go right in.
Yeah.
So that plant would have been intermediate.
Yeah. I've had good success with it.
Have
cut
you?
It, cut it, yeah, cutting it and roasting it.
Cutting it and roasting it. You're, you need to apply a little more flame than you'd generally be comfortable. It's got to be glowing red embers on the stems. And essentially you're trying to penetrate the stem to the root, to that period. So it may be that you come in, you clear a little vegetation around, then you come in, and then I have, you know, definitely set a few fires, so you need somebody there with a backpack sprayer to put them out, or just do it in the rain, or when there's still a little bit of snow on the ground or that it's melting. But this has been a really hopeful technique. I'm excited about it.
Yeah,
there is
too.
Someone using it on a large scale on a big tractor, and he's two of these coming off it, and he's setting, you know, pastures, not on fire, but he's torching multiflora rows. His name's Gary Hawks. If you come across him for a demonstration, it's quite exciting.
The just as a historical point, the city of Northampton years ago used fire as a management tool on the Drumlin near the on the Smith vocational lands that everyone I think is familiar with, that bend in the road. And it was a very successful, but then there was no follow-up. And so it really started growing up into brush. The primary treatment was for multiflora rose, because the whole Drumlin was sort of almost overwhelmed by multiflora. Maybe this is around 1996 or so. Anyway, 3 years ago, they did a big kind of serious brush hogging of that whole place. And it looks really beautiful. It's a nice place to go up. But what's happened, it's not the multiflora rose, but it's now a sea of Asiatic bittersweet. It's unbelievable. So they're considering getting, trying goats in a short, small area, and then if it's economically feasible, they'll get their own goat herd. But anyway, I'm all for fire. We could use more fire in our landscape. But
on that same property, if you walk through the disc golf course portion of it, which we built about 12 years ago and used exclusively hand techniques for controlling bittersweet, you can see what can be done by a small group of people over a decade. They're really, the fairways are almost complete and free, and to the sides is what didn't get done. So, it took a decade, but it looks pretty clear.